In the previous two lectures, we discussed two groups of the cholinergic antagonists, the antimuscarinic agents and the ganglionic blockers. And today we'll discuss the last group, the neuromuscular blockers. These drugs block cholinergic transmission between motor nerve endings and the nicotinic receptors on the skeletal muscle. They have some chemical similarities to acetylcholine. And they are divided into two groups according to their mechanism of action. The nonpolarizing type that acts as antagonists, and depolarizing type that acts as agonists at the receptors on the end plate of the neuromuscular junction. Neuromuscular blockers are clinically useful during surgery, to facilitate tracheal intubation and provide complete muscle relaxation at lower anesthetic doses, allowing for more rapid recovery from anesthesia, and reducing postoperative respiratory depression. To be able to discuss the nonpolarizing and depolarizing neuromuscular blockers, first we should know what is the normal condition of the signal transmission at the neuromuscular junction. The receptors at the neuromuscular junction are channel link receptors, as we discussed in the receptors types lecture. That means when acetylcholine binds to its receptor, the ion channel that is linked to the receptor opens, allowing sodium ions to pass through and enter the cell, causing depolarization and initiation of the response within the cell. So, what are the nonpolarizing neuromuscular blockers? They are just antagonists at these receptors. At low doses, these agents compete with acetylcholine at the nicotinic receptors and block them, leading to prevention of depolarization of the muscle cell membrane and inhibition of muscular contraction. Their competitive action can be overcome by administration of cholinesterase inhibitors, that we discussed before, such as neostigmine and erythronium, which increase the concentration of acetylcholine in the neuromuscular junction. Anesthesiologists employ this strategy to shorten the duration of the neuromuscular blockade. In addition, at low doses the muscle will respond to direct electrical stimulation from a peripheral nerve stimulator to varying degrees, allowing for monitoring of the extent of neuromuscular blockade. And at high doses, nonpolarizing agents can block the ion channels of the motor endplate. This leads to further weakening of neuromuscular transmission, thereby reducing the ability of cholinesterase inhibitors to reverse the actions of the nonpolarizing blockers. So with this complete blockade, the muscle does not respond to direct electrical stimulation. The first drug known to block the skeletal neuromuscular junction was Curare, which native South American hunters of the Amazon region used to paralyze prey. The development of the drug tobocurin followed, but it has been replaced by other agents with fewer adverse effects, such as Cisatracurium, Pancuronium, Rocuronium, and Vecuronium. And as we said, the neuromuscular blockers are administered during surgeries along with anesthetics, allowing to produce muscle relaxation with lower doses of anesthetics. So patients recover quickly and completely after surgery. But they should not be used to substitute for inadequate depth of anesthesia. So, how muscles respond to nonpolarizing neuromuscular blockers? Actually, not all muscles are equally sensitive to blockade by competitive agents. Small, rapidly contracting muscles of the face and eye are most susceptible and are paralyzed first, followed by the fingers, limbs, neck, and trunk muscles. Next, the intercostal muscles are affected, and lastly the diaphragm. And the muscles recover in the reverse manner. Let's talk briefly about the pharmacokinetics of this group. All of these agents are injected intravenously or occasionally intramuscularly since they are not effective orally. These agents are positively charged, as they possess two or more quaternary amines in their structure, that prevent their absorption from the gut, and they do not enter cells or cross the blood-brain barrier. Pancuronium is excreted unchanged in urine. Cisatracurium is degraded spontaneously in plasma and by ester hydrolysis, so it is the only nonpolarizing neuromuscular blocker whose dose does not need to be reduced in patients with renal failure. And it is often used in patients with multisystem organ failure because its metabolism is independent of hepatic or renal function. The aminosteroid drugs Vecuronium and Rocuronium are decetylated in the liver, and their clearance may be prolonged in patients with hepatic disease. These drugs are also excreted unchanged in bile. The choice of an agent depends on the desired onset and duration of the muscle relaxation. Depolarizing blocking agents, such as succinylcholine, work by depolarizing the plasma membrane of the muscle fiber, similar to the action of acetylcholine. However, these agents are more resistant to degradation by acetylcholine esterase, so the depolarizing agent persists at high concentrations in the synaptic cleft, remaining attached to the receptor for a relatively longer time and providing constant stimulation of the receptor. So phase 1, the depolarizing agent first causes the opening of the sodium channel associated with the nicotinic receptors, which results in depolarization of the receptor. And this leads to a transient twitching of the muscle. Then phase 2, membrane repolarizes, but receptor is desensitized to the effect of acetylcholine. Continued binding and continuous depolarization renders the receptor incapable of transmitting further impulses, causing resistance to depolarization and flaccid paralysis. As with the competitive blockers, the respiratory muscles are paralyzed last. Succinylcholine initially produces brief muscle fasciculations that cause muscle soreness. This may be prevented by administering a small dose of nonpolarizing neuromuscular blocker before the succinylcholine. Normally, the duration of action of succinylcholine is extremely short, due to rapid hydrolysis by plasmacetylcholine esterase. However, succinylcholine that gets to the neuromuscular junction is not metabolized by acetylcholine esterase, allowing the agent to bind to nicotinic receptors. And redistribution to plasma is necessary for metabolism. Because of its rapid onset of action, succinylcholine is useful when rapid and at brachial intubation is required during the induction of anesthesia, and is also used during electroconvulsive shock treatment. It is injected intravenously. And it is sometimes given by continuous infusion to maintain a longer duration of effect. Drug effects rapidly disappear upon discontinuation. It has some adverse effects such as hyperthermia. Succinylcholine can potentially induce malignant hyperthermia in susceptible patients. Apnea. Administration of succinylcholine to a patient who is deficient in plasmacholinesterase or who has an atypical form of the enzyme can lead to prolonged apnea due to paralysis of the diaphragm. Hyperkalemia. Succinylcholine increases potassium release from intracellular stores. That's all for this lecture. In the upcoming lecture we will start talking about the adrenergic drugs. Please help me to know if that lecture was useful for you, using like or a comment.